All. This is News Talk.
Hello there, welcome along to Tuesday's Off the Ball. It's Joe here, Jamesy O'Connor and Shane Stapleton on the weekend's hurling, which was once again brilliant. We are having a golden season, it's been amazing stuff. The lads will be in just after 8 o'clock or so. Enda McGinley will join us to talk about Fermanagh and their win over Monaghan. We have Luke Jensen on the French Open, which is ticking along, and all concluding, it seems, in a Rafa Nadal win as Djokovic bows out today. And we'll assess Germany's chances in Russia on the football show and talk a little bit about Ireland against the USA at the weekend. We'll also have Kieran Cunningham with us around 7:30 or so. Another dark day, violent day, involving Irish boxing. 53106 is the text number. We're on Twitter at Off the Ball. Neil Tracy here in studio. Hello, sir.
How are you, Joe? How are you doing?
Very well. Thank you for helping us out with the news around this evening. And Dan McDonald from the Irish Independent. Good evening, sir.
Evening, Joe.
16 years ago, it's been the talk of Twitter. This is one of those things, if you're on Twitter,
you get it.
You are sick of this. You've had this all day. You're like, oh my God, don't talk about this. Whereas if you're in the vast majority of the general population and don't live your life like us journalists with your head in our phone, it may have escaped your attention that it's 16 years ago since this, Jojo.
Forward it goes again by Kinsella. Quinn heads on. Oh, surely this time for Keane. And Ireland do it. Robbie Keane, in the second minute of stoppage time, has scored the equaliser. Look at these scenes. Just look at these scenes.
These scenes, and we deserved it as well.
Yeah,
after a lot of pressure in that second half. Yeah. Nick McCarthy's jaw dropping in the celebration.
Well, it's the head, and then another head
hesitating.
Alex Ferguson was prone to do a bit of the old involuntary
and then
heading.
But you just saw his mouth sort of open, as like, this is actually really happening. And then sort of a vacant jog in the celebration as well. He sort of runs and it's like a guy going the wrong way around a roundabout for a minute, like, you know. And then he eventually reacts. But it's like, it didn't quite master the Mourinho run down the sideline. It was a bit more confused, bemused almost.
If you think the pressure that was on everyone in that tournament, considering the Saipan situation, on Mick especially, this was make or break. I mean, this was career ruination if they had got nothing out of that game and didn't even get out of the group.
It
was
sort of, yeah. I wouldn't go that strong.
I mean, it changed the whole perspective on everything. It was like, okay, we're kind of okay-ish here even without Roy. Whereas it changed the focus. That was, from memory, watching it at the time, that was when we kind of stopped talking about Roy Keane incessantly, and it was then Saudi Arabia happened, and then, you know, it was kind of a moment, a little bit of a before and after in that whole Roy Keane situation within the World Cup. Obviously, it blew up again in the qualification campaign. For younger listeners, that's Robbie Keane scoring 16 years ago against Germany in the World Cup in the 90th minute to equalise. Where were we all? Is the question 16 years ago?
I actually sat and watched that game on my own in the apartment in Dublin.
Nothing has changed in your life.
Well, there's generally someone else there. Because like that was the first summer I spent in Dublin. That I stayed up to live in Dublin. Didn't quite look that hard for a job at the time because the World Cup was on for the month of June, so I was doing a half-hearted effort every day to go out and look for jobs, but then spent a fair bit of time out and about. Anyway, long story short, it was meant to meet people to watch the game, because that was the half-12 game. That was the later game.
Yeah.
And woke up around 28 minutes past 12 going, oh no, what's after happening here? And it was too late to go and meet anyone, and just sat and watched it. Sort of confused silence, you know, just sitting there watching the World Cup slip away the whole time. See, that was the World Cup. If people were, say, 19, 20, 21, around that time, the games were a bit of a dilemma. You'd have, like, games at sort of 7 a.m. in the morning.
Yeah.
So around weekend time, if you were out and about, do you, like, try and stay up and watch the games?
Wasn't it? We can check this online. I don't want to upset anyone. But I think Dunphy was like, you know, I put on the stones to stay awake.
Home. It was an early morning game.
Yeah,
I remember trying to stay up to watch the England-Brazil game when they went out, and with a couple of lads, like, and just gradually falling asleep. Because that was an early one, the one with
the Cameroon one. The early Cameroon one. That was first thing in the morning, 7 or 7:30.
Yeah, I remember that one as well. And
Colin in Belfast here. Lads, I had a very mucky tuna salad on the go when Robbie poked it home against the Germans. It went flying. The carpet still bears the stains, but luckily not the smell, says Colin.
Yeah, you weren't taken out of school for that one, Neil. That was Saipan,
they let me stay in for the day.
You did your leaving cert?
No, I was in sixth class, Joe.
Ah, for the love of God.
St. Paul's National School in Limerick, Mrs. Brooks' classroom was where we watched the Germany game.
But you were taken out of class, wasn't that your story a couple of weeks ago?
Yeah, it was
happened.
the day Roy Keane left slash was sent home or whatever from Saipan. Yeah, my mother phoned the school and asked for the principal to come down and tell me. And he did it. He did it. He brought me aside, broke the news to me gently.
The terror of being sat down, I've got some bad news for you. Your head's going to rest.
Perspective, yeah.
It was in the middle of a game of football, just kind of gently called me aside and broke the news to me there and then.
You were in school as well, Joe, were you?
Yeah, I was in fifth year. Yeah. So I was on my holidays. I 85 to 90% of the reason I did transition year was so as not to be doing my leaving cert during a World Cup. I just knew I couldn't handle that. So I was in fifth year. It was the first time I had a pint in a pub.
During that competition?
During that game.
During the game?
The Germany game.
Yeah. Like actually served in an empty GAA club with two mates.
So Robbie Keane's goal was historic in more ways than one.
Yeah, but like, well, you had one point and went home. I mean, still the same 16 years later, isn't it?
But that is great banter.
But the memory I have with those half 12 games is, I mean, that was a high, you know, and I was just felt like I've missed out on this. Town's probably nuts, and here I am here. Yeah. But the Spain game, of course, which was the half 12 as well, and I think I remember watching that up in the Portobello, and so the game's over around 3 o'clock, Ireland knocked out in penalties, and just walking the streets, and there's all these sort of zombies walking the streets, totally depressed. But you know, God, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon,
I remember
knocked out of the World Cup.
The Spain day as well was amazing. I was watching that in the same pub where I had been served before.
Your second point.
Yeah. I said, I'm getting a taste for this. But I don't know, that must have been a Saturday, because the pub that time was...
It was a Saturday or a Sunday, definitely.
Okay, because...
Definitely a weekend.
It went from being very, very quiet, where it was just me and the other few, and hence we got served, to like mobbed on the Saturday. Mm. And whatever the way the situation was, there was, you know, different corners had their own TV, and one of the TVs was ahead of the other one.
Oh, no.
And like that, you know, that happens routinely in pubs. So for the penalty shootout, there was a mass, like...
Delayed grief.
Yeah. Like, no! And then you knew, oh, God.
Yeah. And then, I'd say rebound and the penalty in normal time would have been really... Like,
confusing.
Really confusing.
Yeah.
Here comes Kilvan. Oh, yeah.
John Watson said there Ireland deserved it. I don't remember the game very well.
I remember nothing really aside from the goals.
I remember Stephen Reid coming on. I think Stephen Reid came on, didn't he? And he did quite well. And there was a bit of pressure. But Germany went ahead early in the match, wasn't it?
I can tell you exactly. Here's the team.
Closest scored early, didn't he?
Yeah. Shea given in goal. We had Steve. God, what a good player Steve Finnan was.
That top class,
we really did have a good team.
That was a bit of a breakthrough tournament for him, though, as well.
So Steve Finnan was at right back. Gary Breen and Steve Staunton were at centre-half. Kenny Cunningham came on for Steve Staunton in the 87th minute. I'm not sure why. Ian Hart, left back. Stephen Reid came on for Hart at 73 minutes.
Yeah.
That's obviously an attacking move. Maybe that's the thinking there. Gary Kelly. Oh, you forget Gary Kelly was in the right wing for Jason McAteer that whole time.
Yeah, McAteer was carrying the injury into the tournament.
Well, actually, interestingly, in the same minute that Stephen Reid came on for Ian Hart, Niall Quinn came on for Gary Kelly, 73 minutes. So then we had Matt Holland and Mark Kinsella in midfield. Kevin Kilbane, heard of him, is on the left-hand side. Robbie Keane and Damien Duff up top. So they were the three subs.
I'm not even sure Finnan started the tournament as first choice. That might have been an adjustment after the Cameroon game as well.
I think what happened there is that Gary Kelly had to move up from McAteer, who got injured in that warm-up game.
I think that rings a bell, all right, yeah.
Subs not used. Lee Carsley, Gary Connolly.
No, that's wrong.
That's wrong.
Gary Doherty, no.
David Connolly.
Yeah.
Per David Connolly. Subs not used. Lee Carsley, Gary Connolly, it says here. This is worse than when Roy got Gary Doherty's name or Richard Dunn's name wrong in his book. Poor Gary Dunn having to sit in the seats. Richard Dunn was on the bench. He was only 22 then, I think. Alan Kelly, Dean Kiley, Jason McAteer, Clinton Morrison, and Andy O'Brien was on the bench as well there. Joe, I'm of a similar vintage to Neil there in studio, which is young. That's what he means.
Always, using the word vintage as well.
Yeah. Like always a great moment when the TV was wheeled into the classroom. It was like Dead Poets Society. Kids jumping on
desks. We had it stationed in our class for the entire month of the World Cup. Because it was the last month of primary school. There was nothing to do.
Text. Robbie Keane was our Robin Williams. Oh, captain, my captain. It's Bitsy and Wicklow.
But I remember Italia 90 in those terms, though, for the TV.
You're a different vintage.
The Romania game is like one of the great sort of memories of Monday, I think it was, yeah.
Lads, on Keane's late goal versus Germany in 02, I still have a scar on my shin from jumping off the couch, whacking the coffee table with my leg. I still relive the sheer joy of the goal every time I glance at that scar, says Dinny in Cork. On my honeymoon in Cyprus, watched the game in a bar. great day. Yeah, I mean, it was, God, it's such a pity we're not at the World Cup, really, when you think back.
It just brings
now.
It home, yeah. If you've seen this, the History Channel have turned into a series of World Cup documentaries.
Very good.
Oh, fantastic, yeah.
My TV is on the blink. So for the last few days, I haven't been able to watch TV for the first time in probably 25 years of my life. And I have to say...
Therapeutic.
It is terrible.
Oh, really?
I have nothing to do. I mean, if you think I was building up to, I've really learned I can live without TV.
There's a decent book behind you there, Joe, you could actually start reading.
No. I tried reading for a while. I was reading those Patrick Melrose books.
Right.
My attention span has just gone to pot.
Yeah, I know.
It's reading the same line 18 times.
Yeah, you can sort of download, watch stuff, like, you know, you can...
No, doing a bit of Netflix. Yeah. I watched Howard Stern with David Letterman.
But the History Channel has turned in, for people maybe not be aware, it's turned into a World Cup channel for, 24/7 for a couple of weeks. Now, there's a bit of filler now, you know, the odd Premier League years has managed to slip in, but... Yeah. There's a couple of great documentaries on Italia 90 in particular. Like, there's a Return to Turin one where, I'm not sure if this is brand new to do with this or is it a couple of years old, but Gary Lineker, Paul Parker and Terry Butcher going back to Turin and reminiscing on their run. But naturally, it overlaps very heavily with the Irish campaign because Ireland started off by playing against England and sort of Bobby Robson comments and Jack Charlton and some of the old footage of, at one point, there was like, was it ITV or someone who did like a video link of Jack Charlton in one screen and Bobby Robson on the other having a bit of crack between the two camps in the lead up to the game. So it's true, like the archive stuff is absolutely tremendous.
I've heard they're very good, the History Channel docs. I saw Miguel Delaney was tweeting about them last week and a few people have said they're really good, so I must
There's a longer one in Italia 90 which is more done not long after the event, which is worth checking out. But yeah, the History Channel, sometimes people just flick by it, but I'd stick with it if you're into your football now.
Yeah. We had some tweets in as well. Jason Kearns said he was in the stand watching it. Lucky you, Jason.
That's the regret I have, not saving up or going broke to go, like, you know.
How many Irish went over? He finished off by saying almost as many Japanese wearing Irish jerseys as travelling Irish fans. How many Irish did go over in 02?
I'm not sure. Yeah. I'm not really sure, like, what type of figure. I mean, just the cost was so substantial. I just definitely couldn't afford it. Mm. You know, you were talking a serious airfare, you know.
Yeah, no doubt. David Roberts, I was sat doing paper 2 of English Junior Cert. Heard a shout from the hallway, get in there, Kino, you beauty. He claims, although I don't believe this, the rest of the exam I continue to write about how amazing Robbie Keane was. Was he on the paper that year? I'm not sure, David. I failed English.
But maybe he did.
Come results night, but I didn't care, I don't care. Come on, is that true?
Who cares? Roll with the story, John.
Okay. Doing English paper 2 when the goal went in, says Robert Giles. The examiner went to everyone in the hall with a post-it note saying Keane had scored an Irish time. No chance.
Because they might have seen, if it was a 12:30 kickoff, they might have seen some of it during lunch,
right? I'm sure, yeah.
That was the afternoon, so.
But would you, if you were the examiner, if you were the person on supervision?
The examiner's probably pretty, you know, pretty screwed up with his gig as well.
Well, they had headphones in, I'm sure, but would you pass post-it notes around to the room?
Maybe.
It was a big deal. It's hard to overstate. Yeah.
I'm sure you could see the stress on a number of students' faces. Like,
yeah. I'm just sort of down with, I mean, that is our last World Cup experience. I mean, this is the thing.
I know.
Bring on these 48-team, 64-team tournaments because there's people over the, you know, anyone 21, say 22, younger than that now, doesn't really have a World Cup memory.
I'm almost slightly more disappointed as we talk now than I was when Denmark beat us. Mm. Like the grim...
The realisation.
Reality.
Yeah, you know? I was aware of that at the time. I was thinking of that.
It's sinking
in. Seeing Ireland at the World Cup is the box to be ticked and you're just sort of wondering.
It is. It's sinking
when will
in.
That happen?
So, let's start the news round. We are here with Air, the home of Air Sport. Get amazing live sporting content free with Air Broadband. And Neil, not surprisingly, you're starting with this story involving Peter Taylor this morning.
Yeah, Joe. Gardaí believe Katie Taylor's father was the target of a shooting in Wicklow this morning, which left a man in his 50s dead. Pete Taylor suffered non-life-threatening injuries in the incident at Bray Boxing Club, which another man is seriously injured from. Around 20 people were believed to be training at the gym at the time of the shooting when a gunman entered the gym and opened fire. And a silver Volkswagen van believed to have been used in the attack has since been located in Dublin, and there's a major manhunt now underway. The IABA released a statement this afternoon. It was a very short statement. They simply say, the IABA are horrified that something like this could happen in the setting of a community sports club. Our thoughts are with those affected by this appalling event, their families and friends.
We'll talk to Kieran Cunningham about this situation at 7:30. It's yet another incident involving boxing, and the brand, if you want to use that terrible term, that is Irish boxing right now is close to being toxic, really. You just associate it with this world now.
Unfortunately, yeah. And that's, I mean, in some ways that's really unfair because, you know, if an incident happens at a, you know, a football club or a GAA club or something, you don't necessarily trace it back to the sport itself in some bizarre way. But
we're not seeing anything comparable.
I know we're not. And it's
and I think we're seeing them at, like, on location at gyms outside the National Stadium a couple of months back. It's not even just people connected with the sport. It's happening there on site.
Well, could you in your right mind now attend an event at the National Stadium? Could you bring your child to watch a line of fights at the National Stadium?
Oh, you'd like to think that you could, but it probably
would you take that chance?
It would play in your mind. I think a lot of people are into, like, boxing training now. It's obviously become very, you know, people who've not on about boxing competitively in terms of the sport, but
this happened at a class.
Yeah, exactly. Like, they like to do a boxing class and stuff like that. So that's the thing that really hits you. You'd like to think, you know, future events in the National Stadium are going to be heavily policed in such a way, but this is a 7 a.m. Yeah. You know, session in the morning. We're reading that there could just be people going along to a class. I mean, I do think of the stadium events. I don't know if I would say, oh, I don't know if I could bring my child to a game in the stadium. That's an event which you think now from now on the card is marked, but this is just a routine morning class.
Mm. Well, you see, people are, on your point about the National Stadium, I take your point. And yet at the same time, you'd also say, well, how much is it worth to me to go?
Would I
even take a 1 in 1,000 chance? Probably not.
No, of course. That's the damage. As you said, that's the brand damage. Mm. You know, that is the brand damage to it.
We'll talk to Kieran Cunningham in about 10, 15 minutes or so about that situation. Manchester United, meanwhile, have made a signing now.
Yeah, their first signing of the summer. They've announced that they've agreed a fee with Shakhtar Donetsk for the 25-year-old midfielder Fred, reportedly around £52 million. The Brazilian's going to sign a 5-year contract at Old Trafford. Left-footed centre midfield player. He played more than 150 games for Shakhtar, scored 15 goals. And it's also reported this evening United are moving quite close to adding Porto right-back Diego Dalot to their squad.
Have you seen much of
Fred? Just the odd Donetsk game, which, you know, occasionally will be on early and stuff like that. But just reading people who've really watched him extensively, to sort of describing him as more of an all-round midfielder, sort of a rounded player that can do a small bit of everything. You can't make like for likes in any way, but obviously Carrick is moving on. You know, they need to sort of strengthen that area.
They need is someone who can sit in beside Matic, do a lot of everything, and allow Pogba try and find something.
Yeah. And he does seem to tick some of those boxes by the descriptions of him. I just saw the Diego Dalot one, the 19-year-old right back, and you're thinking, you know, a year or two back, you're always hoping that Seamus Coleman could get to Man U one day. And it was when Darmian signed, I think you were thinking, well, that's the end of that. Then it turned out he wasn't really up to it.
Yeah.
Dalot was 19. Maybe that transfer, which was definitely floated at one point.
Yeah.
It might just never happen, unfortunately.
Yeah. The Spain game was a Sunday. I know, because after the heartbreak of the penalty shootout, I had to go and watch Cork Kerry Munster final in the pissing rain with somebody.
Oh, no. Yeah.
Oh, dear.
I was doing my English leaving cert paper, went to school on the main Dublin to Derry Road. It was really busy outside the classroom window. When Keno scored, all the lorries in the traffic jam started blowing their horns. 2 minutes later, our principal appears at the little glass window at the door, gesturing 1-1. As we all sat there in silence, making eyes at each other. What a desperately strange environment.
Yeah.
I mean, the Leaving Cert kids had it tough, didn't they? That was a tough generation to be doing your Leaving Cert.
You're just feeling particularly smug with your year.
Well, look, they should have foreseen
the situation. Well, you spent a year in transition paper, in transition year, like folding envelopes or something. You know what I mean?
That was the best year of my life, actually.
Really? What did you do?
Transition year.
What did it actually?
Transition year is amazing.
I found it very beneficial, actually.
No.
I did, yeah, it's good. Like, look, there's a bit of, you know, it's just you're a bit kind of faffing around a little bit. But on the other hand, I remember doing, like, projects on all the different religions in the world and stuff that was actually more applicable to the real world than I found that a lot of the stuff I was doing in French.
Yeah, okay, and I'll give you that. But you also didn't have to miss the World Cup as well, which was the big... That's the bottom line issue, motivation here.
Like, we used to do, in my transition year, we did...
Okay, don't get defensive, Joe. It's fine. I'm sure it was a really worthy time.
It was good. We'd, like, do projects. It felt more akin to what I ended up doing in college, actually.
Right.
Go and work in this thing for 2-3 weeks, as opposed to do your homework every night.
Okay. No, but, it's fine. Listen, you're not on trial here.
Laugh.
It's
fine. We just had a good time.
Yeah, I'm sure you can tell me all about the religions of the world now across the night. I'm not gonna, we can move into them gradually.
Hi, gents. I watched the game in the Sugar Club. An amazing day. I remember the shop I worked in closed for the day, and the next morning checked the voicemail and a customer gave us abuse over closing. I remember thinking, one of the best days ever. Regards, Darren from Dublin 15. Somebody watched the game in Australia with some Dutch lads.
Perfect timing, I'd say.
Some German lads, yeah. Some English lads and Irish lads. Brilliant stuff. Ended up at a foam party afterwards.
And why not?
Cried down the phone to the mammy before that, though, says Ken in Slane, whose foam party days are well and truly behind him now. 16 years on from a foam party. Whoa. Yeah. God, I'd say Ken's feeling old today. Yeah. When was the last foam party?
He's just going to go up and fill the bath now for all time's sake.
Yeah. So, Arsenal have signed in. I hadn't seen this.
Yeah, first signing under Unai Emery. Stefan Lichtsteiner has joined the club. It's looking like a one-year contract. Very, very experienced. 34-year-old Swiss right back. He's joined on a free transfer from Juve. He won a league title in each of his 7 seasons at Juventus, and he's also going to be captaining Switzerland at the World Cup, where he's going to pass his century of caps. He's on 99 at the moment.
He's a good no-nonsense type, experienced type, who'll understand things like positioning and defensive discipline.
Perfect. Yeah, I saw someone tweeting something that was quite clever. It's like something on Championship Manager in your new job. You go for like someone who's experienced and out of contract on a one-year deal. It's a real sort of come in, get a solid character. I'm not sure if it's
sort
like,
out the kids.
Yeah, I'm not sure if it's like thrilling supporters, but it's more let's get some.
But they have enough steel. They have enough thrillers in that team.
Well, they do, and he's used to winning. And he certainly in the playoff with Northern Ireland, he was. I think he was one of the villains of the piece at one point, wasn't he? He's sort of a savvy old veteran, sort of knows how to win.
He's very reliable. Mm. Very reliable.
Is the kind of thing they need. So, some French Open shocks.
Yeah, a couple of them actually. Unseeded Italian Marco Cecconato, world number 72. He'd never been previously beyond the third round of Grand Slam, and he's now into the last 4 at Roland Garros. He's beaten the 12-time Grand Slam winner Novak Djokovic in 4 sets. 25-year-old raced into a 2-set lead, and it looked like a comeback was on when Djokovic took the third 6-1. Djokovic then went 4-1 up in the 4th set, but Cecconato came back in to force a tiebreak and eventually took a 13-11. An absolutely thrilling tiebreak.
Tiebreak was fantastic.
Djokovic is coming back from injury is the context here, but you arrived in somewhat breathlessly at around 6:30 or so.
I was a bit late because I was watching the tiebreak.
The first thing you said was, did you see the tennis?
Yeah.
I said, no, I don't get to see
it's a rare sentence. I don't think I've actually said that in a long time, but just happened to be on.
It's a very Wimbledon thing to say.
I know, yeah. So I'm getting in early. You're like getting in kind of a couple of weeks on. But yeah, the tiebreak, the rallies were all sort of lengthy, sort of 10-plus shots in each one.
Right.
And there was several sort of match points, set points.
A lot of break of serves and everything
as
well.
Yeah, the serve was almost became irrelevant at a point. So that was good. Yeah. It was good viewing.
A bit like reading tennis is something I'm struggling to kind of bed down with for 4 or 5 hours.
Period of time. Yeah.
But then, like,
couple of weeks of a year,
4 times a year.
It's a contradiction that Joey likes. You'd watch golf for 9 hours.
I'm a fascinating and complicated person, full of contradictions, of course. Nothing better than when you get into a tennis match, though.
No, that's it. It's very rare you would get in sort of engaged by one, but this
generally
was just
you're idle, though. You know what I mean? You literally have nothing better to do.
That's a bit damn. You're just applying your own experiences to everyone in the world.
Okay.
Like, some people sort of watch it, you know?
Fair point.
Generally. Read as well.
You actually used the word generally before, as though your experience is the only one that's relevant to everyone else.
Sorry. Okay. Well, you said it was the first time in a long time you'd watched it, so I presume you had literally.
So me and you is absolutely everyone. People in tennis clubs up and down the country, Joe. Don't feel that way.
Fair point.
But yeah.
French Open's on Eurosport in the main.
It is, yeah.
It's not on terrestrial TV.
No,
I don't think so. No, I think BBC used to
usually
have
get the final or something, don't
they?
Yeah. Okay, so Rafa Nadal is still beyond odds on favourite to win this thing.
Yeah, top seed. He's playing tomorrow, but Cecconato's going to play Dominic Thiem in the last 4. He reached a 3rd French Open semi-final in a row, beat the 2nd set Alexander Zverev in straight sets. In the women's draw, Madison Keys and Sloane Stephens have set up an All-American semi-final. It's also going to be a repeat of last year's US Open final, which Stephens won. Keys secured her place in her first French Open semi-final. She beat Kazakhstan's Yulia Putintseva 7-6, 6-4, and Stephens was a 6-3, 6-1 winner against Russia's Daria Kasatkina. Now, in rugby...
I'm going to talk to Luke Jensen, by the way, about all this potentially in the next hour, or if not this evening, then definitely tomorrow. We're going to talk to Luke Jensen, though, about the whole situation. Sorry.
In rugby, Ireland scrum coach Greg Feek says they're going to be making a decision on captaincy for the tour of Australia in the next day or so. As Rory Best absent from the group, Joe Schmidt said last week that either Peter O'Mahony or Johnny Sexton would be his vice captains, but he didn't say who'd be leading the side this week. First test is this Saturday at the Suncorp Stadium in Brisbane before they head down to Melbourne and then Sydney. But Greg Feek, the scrum coach, was before the media today and he played down the importance of the role, saying it could be any one of the players in their leadership group.
Well, the captaincy is again, you know, sort of same thing. Like, we've had a leadership group that's been pretty solid and tight, and any one of those guys could step in. So that's the decision again, I think, will either be made in the next 24 hours. It could be made in the next hour or so, yeah. Well, there's CJ, there's Pete, Johnny, Besties in there, Connor, Ilzy.
There we are. That's Greg Feek. You were in doing the pay-per-view on Sunday, Dan. Interesting backdrop to this game with what's going on in the Australian team, yeah, in that Israel Folau is quite understandably causing more than a degree of controversy across Australian rugby and just Australia generally, because he was asked for his opinion on homosexuals and said they will burn in hell.
He wasn't even asked, he just tweeted it.
Did he?
His response.
Oh, he just tweeted it.
Was it a response to something? No, he just tweeted it.
I think it might have been in response to something he had seen, but it wasn't even put to him, you know?
Okay. So he means this very literally. He's not speaking any other way than this is actually what's going to happen, unless they repent, of course, he added. So he did give them a route
back.
It's
always a caveat,
yeah. It's very, very good of him. And he's had to sit down with the CEO of Australian Rugby, and he's made it very clear to her that under no circumstances am I retracting this or taking this back. This is what I think. Deal with it. And then David Pocock has come out now. Mm-hmm. The captain said he strongly disagrees with Folau, insists it won't affect harmony within the group. But it's a very difficult situation. And we were trying to tease out on Sunday, to what extent should someone's views prohibit them from representing the country? I mean, do you now have to tick two boxes, i.e. the sporting, you know, how good you are at sport as one, and then two, your views? On the other hand, you said, you know, someone like Pocock has very liberal views. We celebrate them, we give them a platform, we think they're brilliant, and we amplify them.
Yeah, no, it's true.
It's a bit of a messy one for them. And Michael Cech is trying to juggle that whole situation.
I think the coach's position is particularly difficult. Yeah.
So we'll see how that one plays out over the next few days. Might do a piece on it. I think Matt Williams is going to join us actually on Wednesday Night Rugby tomorrow. So that is our news round done for this evening. You can keep your memories of 0-2 coming. We'll come back to some of them on the football show after 9 o'clock. But up next, we'll talk to Kieran Cunningham about the continuing strife surrounding Irish boxing.
Off the Ball on News Talk.
Hi, I'm Brendan Cabman, CEO of GDPRcourse.com. GDPR became law on Friday, May 25th. Are you worried that your business, volunteer organisation or club is at risk of being fined? We now run daily accredited GDPR practical implementation courses at our nationwide training facilities. This course gives members of your organisation tasked with GDPR the practical tools to implement and maintain GDPR compliance. Don't get ripped off by expensive consultants. Go to GDPRcourse.com.
Every ultimate experience Ireland has to offer is always within reach with a 182 BMW. The ultimate bowl of chowder, seasoned with Atlantic salt air, the ultimate swim spot, even the ultimate scenic shortcut that happily takes way, way longer. Experience the ultimate with a 24-hour test drive from your local BMW retailer. Because owning your new BMW is always within reach. Visit bmw182.ie.
Adrian and Mary did their full shop at Lidl, saving even more thanks to our 400 plus price drops. Like Irish lamb was $8.99, now only $7.19. 65 wash colour detergent was $5.99, now $5.35. And Irish cheddar cheese was $1.89, now $1.29. Lidl, more for you.
It's the ultimate food lovers festival. Taste of Dublin, inspired by Neff, returns to the Ivy Gardens from the 14th to the 17th of June. Join the summer's biggest and best foodie event, led by world-class chefs, with top restaurants, interactive masterclasses, incredible drinks, and live entertainment. Join the Food Lovers Playground at Taste of Dublin Ivy Gardens, June 14th to 17th. Book now. Tickets on sale at tasteofdublin.ie. Booking fees apply.
Chill Insurance do travel cover. Getaway. Oh, see what I did there? Visit chill.ie.